there was the jive, that was closely followed by the pogo, and of course there was the twist, and who amongst us can forget the strut? Anyway, now young people in the Northwest are collectively swivelling their hips in the most unusual way to some highly intoxicating music. So what exactly is going on? Well, we've gone on down there, as they say, to find out exactly what.
Fusion started off fusion days. Shalamar, African Mbata, all them groups in the old days. That's what inspired me.
Broken Glass sort of started back in the early 80s, 1983 to be exact. Me personally got into the scene around 82 with the advent of Top and Pops with Shalamar.
Yeah, it was 1982, Jeffrey Daniels first done the body popping on, I think it was Top of the Pops, and he'd done the moonwalk, and I was really amazed about that. So that's what first got me into popping and breaking and in general sort of like dancing.
Match you remember, anyway. It was the advent of seeing Jeffrey Daniels on there, he was doing all this sort of like, it was sort of a cross between initially robotics and mine, like famous, the original Eminem, is it Mars or Mars Play? With all the white gloves. So it was sort of like really amazing to see that, but I think the thing that sort of clinched it for me, and I think most people who watched it, this the backslide, which is like what was now known as the Michael Jackson moonwalk.
So many guys were just breaking out and becoming so diverse. People that you knew, right, just like everyday guys used to just go out, buy clothes, do what they were doing, and then all of a sudden there was this like massive release.
First and foremost, I think like everybody that started up round about circa 83, 82, Buffalo Girls was basically the first time I'd actually seen hip hop culture, Malcolm McLaren's Buffalo Girls, actually seeing the culture, seeing the Double Dutch, seeing the B-Boy, seeing Poppin', seeing Rocksteady Crew, Over Beats. That was the first time I'd seen it. But like I'd heard the message before, and yeah, there was kind of a lot of really instrumental sort of things that were put out around about that time. African Mumbai, you know, Search for the Perfect Beat, Rock, Pat Jam. So, you know, I came into hip hop in a very early electro scene. So that was even before MCs even took kind of control, you know. So I was kind of, that's really where I was inspired.
Video came out by Malcolm McLaren called The Buffalo Girls, and you got to remember sort of like suddenly there was this whole impact of stuff, because you got to remember back then it was like it was only 2 years after like the Moss Side, well the riots that went across the country, Moss Side, Liverpool, Brixton, so there was still that sort of animosity in the air and that sort of tension. Even though it was 2 years on, and it was like, I mean, even though it's all the governments and the police were saying they're going to change this and that, it was still there, and nothing really had much change for the people who were affected. So for people at my age, who were teenagers growing up in that era, there was really nothing to do.
You've got to remember, like, in the early 80s,
As young black people, we didn't have anything to hang on to. We wasn't represented in the media. We wasn't really represented in radio. You know, we had nothing. We had catch a Google, for Christ's sake. I mean, we didn't have anything that really we could relate to.
No, but that was it. You know, people didn't have that money, but somehow they found a way. You know, and it was vital, you know, like, that they were out at these kind of clubs, because, you know, that was the release in life, you know, like, to be out in the clubs and the dancing was so serious at first, you know, like, a lot of the best dancers were dancing, like, jazz fusion.
Used to get videos from the States and study them frame by frame. I'm talking big videos like this as well, you know, like, that Toto, you know, and we used to study them. And then get the moves, and that's how it started, basically getting the crew just built up from there.
Then we used to watch the Americans, and then we started breakdancing in my house. I had a piece of Lionel in my living room, in my living room, not Tim's, my living room.
We used to like go around to get Lionels and stuff, like go to the market and pay like a fiver for a Lionel. We used to go out practicing and stuff and breakdancing and on it. And obviously someone had to have the Lionel, and eventually the Lionel ended up at Swanee's house. So it ended up in Swanee's living room, so Swanee used to be able to practice on it. And we all ended up going round to Swanee's to practice in his house.
And we used to sort of like go straight from school down to Royce's, just about 6 or 7 of us strong, walking down, sitting in his house.
And then that was it. We'd probably have a drink, Coca-Cola and stuff like that, and munchies, and mostly like Kentucky's, who like round the corner on the 49. So we used to like chip in and get it there. And we were just like hogs. I mean, bargain bucketing up, and everyone was like, and then that's it.
And more drinking. That was it. We was out inside in his back garden, doing the popping and the breaking.
Everyone used to come over, and we used to try out different moves. Me personally, if I woke up and I thought of a move while I was asleep, because I had a Lionel in my room, I'd just get up and I'd go out and just do the move. So I'd have my move there.
And then off the back of that, then I seen Broken Glass, Rim Campbell, Bones, Tim, Patrick, Danny Price, Swanee Hall, Pete, Kevin Love, all the mans were basically, I'd see them on Granada Report since me as a kid. And the funny thing about it was that I was going to Chorley High in Chorlton, and Raymond Campbell, my hero, was going to Wilbraham, so he was kind of the guy that I really wanted to kind of track down. But that's where MBOY started from. So I started off from getting into hip hop, hearing the American music scene, their videos, but in terms of influences with Broken Glass, and that was local crews with local people, so that's how I started.
I had my first audition into Broken Glass when Greg was doing something in Salford, and said, look, well, check if it was like Ozzy or somebody. I brought us down there and said, look, well, check this guy out. Or if it was Paul Brenshaw, and said, check this guy out. And I just did a couple of head spins, a couple of moves, and Greg just went,
head,
you're
slams.
In. That's it, get in there.
I ended up dancing at the competitions, basically, because the crew were there, but because it was so new, there wasn't really enough B-boys to sort of like make a thing of it. And like, because I always hang around with the crew from the, like, when they first started. This is all, well, you go in and just help to make the numbers. So that's how I went in. And then there's other people like Danny Price, who went in the competition that night. And then after that, Greg Wilson made the case in point for me that when he danced and he actually performed as well. Because I sort of was like kind of nervous, but I sort of didn't make a ton of things, like pretending to do body weights and stuff like that. So it got the audience laughing and sort of relating to it. So it sort of helped to ease that up, and I think he picked up on that. So that's how that night he became official members of the crew.
Involved when I went to Wigan on a Tuesday night once. Mike Shafton, I think Greg Wilson was the DJ, and there's that's challenges and things and so on. So I danced, never really been out to Liverpool at the time. Greg got offered me the part of the team. So that's when I moved to Manchester after a few years and travelled all over.
I had to literally back school because I wanted to be a member. I'm only 14, I won't the action. But before you knew it, I was on the bandwagon again. That's how I initially got into it.
I joined Broken Glass. I think I joined Broken Glass pretty late. I'd have joined them about, I think, maybe 85, maybe 84. I'm not quite sure, but around about that period. But basically, it was a time when trades and labour was still going. And I was dancing, and I was battling another crew called Renegade, and I was on my own. I didn't really have a crew, but there was a bunch of fuckers. And I was used to go down and try and battle them. And at that point, I got spotted by Patrick and Danny, and they kind of says, well, look, if you want to do an audition. And I was like, my God, to audition for this crew. Because by that time, Broken Glass had already had a record out, it was being played, it was already in Granada reports. So, I mean, it was like joining a super crew or super group. So, anybody was anybody who wanted to be part of the crew.
I know it's a great dancer, it's a great dancer. It's a great dancer that makes me a great dancer now for 24 years. I was in a group called Broken Glass. Tim Forde, Danny Price, Patrick Booth, Russell Swanston, the late Russell Swanston. And now I'm the dance leader for Ogham.
Fusion, jazz, disco. We used to go to a lot of fusion and jazz clubs and disco clubs, i.e. Rotters, which you didn't really want to hear, did you? But never mind.
Berlin's.
Berlin's was the one. Legends. Berlin's.
Everything about it.
Legends.
Everything about it.
Yeah, that was the one.
In town, a club called Legends, who the DJ was called Greg Wilson at the time. It's called Fifth Avenue now. I don't know what sort of music it plays now, but it's a whole different scene. But that's for us. That was almost like the Broken Glass Bay Show. It was a showcase. So everything that we've been practicing all week was showcased there. If it was in the form of challenging an open cruiser, just showing off without amongst ourselves. You know what I mean? The open cruise in Manchester that we'd be challenging, and it was one of those clubs where, because it was a black lunacy, it was quite limited, so people from all over would come from everywhere. So you have people from Birmingham, so people who saw us would go back talking about us, and eventually now cruise from different places.
Yeah, Birmingham coming down, Leeds, London, all over the place coming down to challenge the Broken Glass, and we defended that to the fullest.
I got my colours on my
this
own!
This is turf. You can't come in our turf and take our things. There's no way.
Oh, yeah.
We started dancing on the streets. We started doing street dancing as well. Piccadilly. Yeah. Wigan.
Yeah, Wigan Pit.
Yeah, Wigan. That was a good one. Geez, what is it now? Gallery. We were started dancing in the gallery as well. Yeah, and that's in the gallery, not small.
So this is the hacienda. This is where Greg first took us to doing a gig here. This is like a more like an alternative club, sort of like Smiths and people into goths and the new romantics. So it was almost like the extreme scene to us, you know what I mean, musically and artistically, everything. So when he wanted us to come here, we were sort of a bit reluctant. Until they point out the fact that, you know, like sort of like the clubs that we are doing, like Wigan Pier and Legends and Gallery, which was a black club scene, so everybody sort of like heard of us and we were sort of like wild the floor. So he was sort of like, I don't know if he suggested or someone else said, like, because this is like a fresh thing that we're doing and these people haven't seen it before, it'll blow them away. Which pretty much changed everybody's attitude, I think, because everybody was like, yeah. Well, I'm going to try this move, when we get there, I'm going to do that. Oh, you know what I mean? So we went into the Hacienda knowing that it's an alternative club and we might not be liked because we're sort of blacks from the ghetto and we're coming into this sort of scene, you know what I mean? But that changed from that point where we sort of like, we'll wait till we see what we do. And we went in there with that intention and that enthusiasm, you might say. And we just blew the place away, do you know what I mean? Because as soon as we started, I think they kind of appreciated it as well. Because you got to remember, this is sort of the early 80s and the alternative scene was still fairly new.
We did have some really good nights. We had Houdini came and played. It was a great night. Nutriments, who were British, they did the first British electro track called London Bridges Falling Down. And they came down. That night was when Broken Glass really came of age, because they were in the audience. And Nutriments had brought a couple of breakdancers or with your poppers, I can't remember, with them. And they'd come with an attitude of, we're going to show you something here, you haven't seen this before. They didn't realise what was going on in Manchester at the time. And, you know, it ended up with a challenge between them and the Broken Glass guys, and nobody was even bothered watching Nutriment anymore. Everyone was watching what was going on there. And I think Broken Glass were loved at the Hacienda. I think that they had a lot to do with giving the club a credibility from the black side of things. I used to also do the Saturday night for an hour to acclimatise the normal Hacienda audience, the type of music I was playing. And even though a lot of them weren't into it, Broken Glass came and danced on the stage during my spot.
So it sort of gelled, and then from then on, I think, once this sort of, like, we started getting regulars, Greg got a regular spot there and we started coming down on a regular night. And I think that's what helped develop the dance scene. Because like we had the very first breakdance competition was there, and I think, and I'm sure Tony Wilson was there as well. So I think maybe people like him and who had more influence in the running of the place saw the potential of what could go on. Do you know what I mean? So from then on, the dancing sort of grew. I mean, and now you had things like Factory Labels, Happy Mondays, you had all that sort of scene.
The funny thing about that was, it's like there was a lot of people that were like really, really smooth soul heads. Right, and they were like really, really cool. Do you know what I mean? And then all of a sudden you've got this group of guys come down with bags on the back.
Mm.
And
got ready to sweat.
Bag full of tracksuits and everything.
Ready to
and
sweat.
Everybody's out for a nice night. And then all of a sudden, boom. But the thing that I really, really respected about that is that everybody just stopped to check out what you were about.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Well, that's it. They really liked it.
Me, personally, I just jumped in there head first, literally.
Slam!
Literally. And from then, get on your head, mate.
Not me, I was body popping.
Yeah, and he was a good popper too.
Oh, damn.
He was damn smooth. He was smooth.
For me, it's like we did this TV show called The Tube, and I remember it was in the changing room, and there was a cubicle off, and there was some woman behind there. I didn't really know much about her. One of the guys said, oh, go and ask that woman for a light round there, you know what I mean? So I went round and I think somebody even mentioned, oh, that's Madonna, and we sort of laughed it off, because when we heard the track Holiday, that was in the sort of black clubs, and we assumed it was a black person singing it, because there was no pictures of her on the records at that time, when that first came out, so it was very dismissive. So I just went up to her and sort of asked her for a light, and she sort of went, do I look like a girl like? Oops, I left it out there and I thought, oh, never mind, it'd just be a one-hit wonder anyway, do you know what I mean? Because
I left it out how wrong I was there. Because that would turn up to be Madonna, you know what I mean? Singing Holiday.
And also seeing Broken Glasses in the Jam back at Stretford, you know, at Baddeley Hall, seeing Broken Glass down at, there's so many numerous clubs that I can hardly remember, but Legends would have been one of them. They were ghetto heroes. So anybody who wanted to join that group wanted to kind of join in and feel part of that kudos that Broken Glass had.
For me though, it was, you know, it was phenomenal because I used to get sort of like big response of people. I couldn't even walk down the street at one time without people.
You used to walk on the street, I mean not walk on the street, I mean walk onto the floor and people used to go, whoa, whoa. It's like, I fear him.
Yeah, I used to walk down the street and people used to come up to me, it's like people I didn't even know and say, you're Raymond Campbell. I was like, who are you? I was like, can you do this? And I'm like, all right, then can you do this? So it's sort of like, it was good because I got quite a bit of recognition back then. I was kind of shocked, really, because, you know, I was classed as good, but I never thought I was as classed as that good.
Do you know what I think it comes down to? I think we were famous.
Mm-hmm. When you said before about, you know, people influence and stuff, after Rocksteady Crew, Broken Glass, they were the first big crew on the Manchester scene, perhaps on the British scene, one of the first, perhaps you in London all started, you know. But certainly Manchester, Broken Glass were well established by the time I got going and then I joined Street Machine and then we had a couple of challenges, didn't we?
Broken Glass
and Street Machine.
I'm telling you, man, all the crews we challenged in England, despite Rock City Crew were from Nottingham and Street Machine were probably...
Mate, when you say we give you the most trouble, did we not give you a whooping one time?
No. I'll cut the camera. Just turn off the camera and stop recording.
Is it giving you a bit of trouble, an understatement, mate?
The final winners were Street Machine in the breakdancing section and Dave the Wave, the body popper.
Manchester's number one body popper in 1985, which wasn't bad for the white guy from Liverpool.
No, I'm saying if we were challenged three times you walked us twice and we got you once, so we at least came.
We got us up the Tropicana when we weren't ready.
We just come back off tour. Tired, you know, jet lag.
You were going around the country at that time, weren't you? All the same tracksuits on, making too much money, selling out, weren't you? You came back and got bought by some authentic lads.
What's the difference between breaking and popping?
Popping, using your body. On standing straight on the floor, if you're creating the floor, but when you're breaking, you're using your hands up and spinning your leg.
It's a lot more aggressive. You're on the streets, and you're a lot more liable to break your bones, that's why it's
the difference between body popping and breaking is breaking is sort of like urban physical gymnastics, where body popping is more like the physical art of illusion, waving, all that sort of stuff to give the illusion that the body's doing something that it isn't.
Like the breakers and the poppers. The poppers mainly using body movement, muscular control, using the legs a lot more. Whereas we've got breakers with Danny and Patrick, who are breaking the floor using spinning on the backs, their heads, and generally being able to come up and form a good basic movement.
Completely different aesthetics. It's like, what's the difference between body popping and ballet, or what's the difference between breaking and ballet? Okay, first of all, breaking is kind of something where it's about the human body and gravity and the floor. It's about looking at how one spins, breaks, dances to the rhythm, and how one kind of expresses himself but on the floor, similar to capoeira but not capoeira. Whereas body popping, it's something that is done that's stood up. It's more syncopated in terms of hitting the beats. It's a stood up form. It would probably be similar to me from where I got into hip hop, closer to kind of straight mime. But yeah, that's the difference. So one was more of a floor aesthetic, one was more of a stood up aesthetic.
Body popping is not really dangerous. It's blatancy, because if you say spin your head and you have to tense your neck, and if you don't tense it, loosen it, let it snap. Body popping is just, it's said that you can move your muscles from actually locking, but I don't really think you can.
Now, there's different types of breaking, isn't there? Can you try and explain it to us?
I'm not really a breaker, I'm a body popper.
What do you do?
Body popping.
Body popping is more waving and clicking your body. Break dancing is more gymnastics, chucking your body around like you don't care. Is breakdancing dead? Are you joking? I wish there was about four of me. I could make a lot of money. I do 56 skills back and forwards all year round. Some skills I've been in like for 2 to 3 years and they keep folding me back because basically they're trying to get lads to learn dance and the only dance that they'll do is breakdancing, body popping, and robotics. You won't do contemporary for some reason. So breakdancing is not dead.
No, not at all. I think it's more alive. It's more underground. It's like the dance music scene. Eventually, it comes up, and then it goes back down to its original roots.
Comes around. Yeah. It's come back around again.
I don't think it'll enter into sort of like popular culture as a sort of like a dominant form of doing things because. It seemed like an extreme sport, you know, the complexity of the moves that are actually being performed today.
Yeah, all the hand mimals.
It's far beyond your average person. I mean, you'd actually have to have a passion for this, like you'd have to actually have to have a passion for, say, gymnastics or running. You'd have to actually be in a part of your life. Yeah, I don't think from a social situation it'll become as popular. Do you know what I mean? Which is good for it because then it makes it an art form even more in its own right.
When you look at breaking, you look at different styles of martial arts as well. Mm. That's where, you know, some of that is generated from, like, sort of capoeira and stuff like that. Yeah. You know, it's all floor moves and kickovers and stuff like that. So, yeah, it's more energetic.
It's just like they used today. They tend to be a bit more lazy than back when we used to dance. You know, to be, when they see all the moves, they want to do it, but they won't. It takes hours and hours of practice. Hours of practice. Some of them just don't want to do that. But the ones who do, you know, breakdancing has a big influence on them.
And I hooked up with Swanee again, and he sort of reintroduced me to the breakdancing. Because as far as I concerned, it's sort of, as far as I knew, it got to the top of the 80s, and that was it. And it, the only thing that was going to be reminiscent of it is our own memories of it back then. So when he showed me the stuff that we were doing today, I was like, because it was just like, being back in 1983 and seeing it on TV the first time, it's like, but the level that it is today is just like, it's not like, how did you think? It's not just like, how did you think of it? But where did you go to, like, practice it?
Breakdancing today is unbelievable. You should see the stuff doing today. It's just like, you can't do that. You see the moves and you think, what the hell?
And me personally, I'll be glad if, you know, they splash it all over MTV and splash it all over this instead of having all the booty dancers, you know, and all this, you know, because it's good to see something creative, you know. Not just the girls, like, man, they look good and everything, man, but, you know, you want to put it back in the music, you want to put the dance back in the music, and that's what you need.
Well, actually, I think if we're talking about 2006, and then we take it back another decade to 96. The breakdance in 96 was interesting in terms of a lot of blow up moves were being made, but people weren't really interested in kind of. They weren't interested in how they articulated music within their dance form. So what you had was a lot of big things like air tracks, air chairs, you know, huge windmills, head spins, helmet spins. But what the people were doing, they were articulating dance or articulating music through their dance. As I think in 2006, you do have people like Mouse who can do the most amazing things. Puff, Irvine, you know, who can do absolutely amazing things as breakdancers, but also they're completely grounded in their musicality. So what you have now is you have almost a throwback energy where people are really interested in your up rock, your down rock, you know, your floor moves, how you get into something, your musicality of how you get into it. Somebody like Ken Swift is constantly reinventing, finding new ways of being able to get into kind of pretty old stock moves, but the way that he will do it is absolutely amazing, and it's his style that is most important.
Of course, back in 1978, first time I saw anything underground and radical was graffiti. He was writing. My brother was a writer. He used to write on the subway trains. And I had been living on 96th Street in Amsterdam and Columbus. And in 77, I moved to 97 to 98 in Amsterdam. And being over there was a little bit different from where I was at. It was closer to the projects. And walking uptown from where I was at, I would go by and hear music and stuff like that. The first time I ever saw it in its real state was at a park on 100th Street in Amsterdam Avenue. It was dark, it was at night. There was a little bit of light from the park lights. Apparently they took some electricity from one of the street poles and they plugged in turntables, speakers. And it was kind of dark, but people out there, the only light that you could really see was the light that was on the turntables, like really lit up, where the people were DJing, because they had to see all their wiring and all the connections and everything. So, walked through there, you know, just playing, seeing people from the neighborhood, you know. Some people I knew, some people I didn't. But then, you know, there was this like little group of people, just like in a certain area, I didn't know what was going on. Walked over there and saw people in there dancing. Then I put it together, I was like, okay, that's that stuff. I had seen it a couple times before, but personally through a friend. Dole showed me a shuffle one time, and my boy Dante, he did a spin and a split when I was little in front of a record shop, and those are the first times.
But it's also style, content, and musicality. And that's when if I judge a competition, that's exactly what I'm looking for. I'm not just looking for blow up moves, I'm looking for how somebody dances, and are they embodying the music in the way that they move. Because if you're not doing that, you're not representing B-boy, you're not representing popping, you know, and basically you wouldn't have been able to get away with that back in the day, because it was about the dance. People were constantly dancing. It's a social dance, so you need to move with the music, you need to be inspired by the music. So now, in 2006, I think that a lot of people are moving towards, oh, you want beat, how nice are you? You know, because otherwise people are going, well, you're great at these big blow up moves, but if you haven't got no musicality, it doesn't really work.
I always knew that this would never disappear from any community, because I know there would always be some kid doing it. I knew it would never die. It never did die. You know, I can't see how any human being can say something is dead. We have billions of people on this planet. The idea of us bringing and being a part of bringing it around the world through media, once it got on television and tape, it was a wrap. I knew it would never die, because the way I received it and the energy I felt initially, I knew other kids, back when they see it, they want to love it just as much. And you know, then you know, it will be just a test of how they felt about it after a year or two, to see if they really wanted to stay doing it. Because, you know, society wasn't really trying to hear it after a while. They were like, okay, we're done with that. The media was like, okay, we used it up, we can't really use it no more. And then it dealt with the individual and how they felt about music and dance, if they wanted to stay. And a lot of people left. A lot of people just left after 2 or 3 years. It just felt like, well, there's no money involved. And then other people were like, well, no one's doing it. And other people were like, well, this played out. So it kind of went its own way, but we would have never imagined it to be where it is now, back in the days. I never thought about where it would be now. Yeah. I was just having fun for the moment. We were just enjoying ourselves.
Turtle, windmill, air flares, there's all new names that they've got, and it's just, you've just got to see it to believe it. You won't believe it when you see it. You just end up cursing. I do, because I can't do them. I'm old school. Pause that a second. I think way down in the future, it'll be still there. People think it's gone out now. I'm teaching in schools 20 to 40 pupils a day. I'm doing 3 or 4 schools a day, and I can't see it let up. Every time the 6 weeks holiday, I think it's going to go quiet. I just get pure phone calls to get me into schools to learn breakdancing, to teach breakdancing. So I don't think it's going to go out of fashion. No chance. If it does, I'm out of a job. Because that's all I can do. What would you give me? What was that? You made me laugh, man. That's it.
That's it.